Good afternoon. I think it's time for me to start my presentation. Thank you for attending my session. My session is called Understanding Scalability and Performance Net Kubernetes Master. My colleague Chen Xingyu Chen Fansong and I will deliver the speech, and also all of us are from Alibaba Cloud, so we'll talk about how we use Kubernetes to do our work in terms of performance and our practice. If you look at the agenda, we have four parts to be covered. Number one, the background. Why do we need to use Kubernetes and the history of using Kubernetes? We'll also talk about the Kubernetes usage in Alibaba. Number three, we'll talk about the experiences on scalability. And we'll talk about our problems in using Kubernetes in terms of apiserver, apiserver controller and scheduler, and last part will be the Q&A session. And number one, we'll talk about the resources the management and the scheduling history. In 2013, we used the AI system to control our resources. In 2015, we use Swarm to develop those and this scheduler system. In 2017, we used the Sigma system. We developed a Sigma system. In 2018, we initiated Kubernetes to be a new engine for the resources allocation and scheduling. Within our Alibaba, we have this 10,000 of applications covering Tmall, Taobao, and other applications. And we have 1 million containers. If you look at the peak, it will be very high. The peak will appear in the Double Eleven shopping day. Now we have 10 SF clusters, 10,000 of nodes, and 10,000 nodes, and we use Kubernetes. And we know that Rome was built in a day. We didn't expand the cluster to 10,000. We use KubeMark. And I believe that a lot of you are familiar with that. The KubeMark. We use KubeMark to simulate the holonodes and to simulate into the 10,000 scale. We suppose the pod is 200,000. For all the objects, it includes the services and configure maps and sequence, and about 1,000K. And in this case, use KubeMark to do the simulation. We find some latency, and this search latency, get pod and get nodes, and some scheduler latency. The latency will be about 10 milliseconds. So for such a Kubernetes, we believe that such a latency is a big problem for us. And I believe that for this for this latency, I believe there are a lot of reasons. When we did Kubernetes, it's open source, like a very average car. When it's reached a very high scale or very large scale, if let's say if you want to run on the motorway, the components will not meet the requirements of this new situation. If you look at this graph, I believe that it just demonstrate the Kubernetes whole structure, and we find that the etcd will be a bottleneck for our large scale application. When the etcd is at a very large scale, and we'll find some problems, let's say the etcd read and write latency increase or hike. If you use the etcd, you'll find that there will be too many new request error, and I believe that it will happen when there are a lot of nodes, or DDoS attack will occur, and For the recommended etcd space, we're very limited. If you want to save a large amount of data or the metadata, and there will be the maximum for your storage. That's why the etcd will stop us providing service. Apart from etcd, the scheduler need to schedule or call a container. The efficiency will be very low and the latency will occur. If you look at controller, the controller cannot meet the requirements of this node update, and there will be some failure or to our source version, some errors. And the last but not least, when you reach such a large-scale nodes, if one of the components just fail, and the reboot will take some time, it will lead to a low efficiency, it will lower your SLC. And in response to these problems within our Alibaba, we make some optimization on the components. Let's look at the etcd. In terms of etcd, for starters, we use etcd 1.0 technology that deal with this large amount of data storage. Etcd programmacy. If this node value and pod value can be saved in a KB cluster, we call it tilt cluster within our Alibaba. By doing this, for this large values can be stored in this way. Now we can handle the storage problem, but there are other problems. Let's say if you run this tail cluster or this cluster, there will be some data migration. There will be very high latency, and all of data will be stored within a one etcd cluster. It will be easy for us to see some data isolation. If you operate a resource and the resource will see a hike, it will affect other resources. So that's why we have this right-hand graph. This is called 2.0 structure. We're based on apiserver with different resources. It means that from the key. The K prefix are different. We just divided into different etcd clusters. By doing this, the etcd clusters can have a high storage. Because it's just divided into different etcd clusters that will see different router groups, so that's why the data isolation can handle it pretty well. Let's say the event cluster, the pod node can be separated, the node can be separated, and we all of this can adopt this approach. When the 2.0 is finished updating, it will look at this left-hand graph. The one etcd cluster is not enough, we can use other etcd cluster to handle this problem. But maybe we can have another approach to improve the capability of one etcd, the single etcd cluster. We can find the bottleneck of this performance. We can just focus on this bottleneck. In response to this bottleneck, we have this 3.0 version cluster, and with this trials, we can find the bottleneck of this performance. If you look at the right hand graph, the structure, you find the underlying storage, and it is a page distribution algorithm. When a user needs to save new data within the etcd, it maintains free list storage page space. We know there will be an internal maintaining pool. It's just something like this. It's like free list space. I don't know whether it's clear for you. If you look at here, this structure here, and if you look at the red part, red represent it is in usage. It means that data are stored in this part. You can just interpret it as a small data storage module. It's about 4K. And the white part represent it's not used. We can use algorithm from left to the right, the 51 and 52 can be sent to return to the user. For the ETCD itself, it's a single scanning algorithm. When the N is very big or the storage is very big, and the search or query time will be increasing. For the users, they will find that when the storage is very high and storage latency will be hiking, so that's why we've got such a problem. So that's why we adopt a new algorithm. We call the segregation hash map algorithm. With this algorithm,
and
use the K of the same page. For the
sequence
storage structure, we can just transfer it into this graph. We call it frame map.
It's
size
V1.
For the consecutive pages, 1. The front page is 42. And size 2 will be 51. Size 3 with 47. For this new data structure, when we need a new page and the query time will be very fast. If you call it the sequence, the query will be very low. If you use the hash map, it will be very fast. So for the from ON to O1, so that's why the performance is improved a lot. In a meanwhile, when there is this page recycling for the 45 and 46, let's say we just recover it or recycle it, we use hash map algorithm to do it. When it's released first, and the previous page will see that whether there is some possibility of the combination. And with these two moves, the combination, the previous one, the combination with this latter one, so these two can be combined into a big one. Let's say the combined 45 and 46 will just transfer into this size 1, size 2, and we can find that this page 44 turned into this page 6. So that's why we have such a whole combination. You can have a look at the slide, the structure is very clear. And for this new ETCD version, we'll use it. And for these corresponding algorithms, due to time constraint, I cannot go into details here. And you can just check or click on my blog, and you can find this whole approach of doing this structure. And with this several gigabyte, we can make it in hundreds of gigabyte. And I believe that we can make the performance 20 times higher than before. In terms of ETCD, I just stop here. Now let's invite my colleague and Zeng Fansong, and he will introduce the other optimization. And due to time constraint, without further ado, I will start to talk about the efficient node heartbeats. I don't know what version do you use this Kubernetes. For our Alibaba, we use this 1.10 version of Kubernetes. if we want to scale it into 10,000 or even higher, I believe that one of the biggest problems for us to be confronted with how to deal with this node heartbeats. With many nodes, the heartbeat will be very higher than before. If you you will know that every 10 seconds the Kubernetes will send heartbeats. And there will be for this production nodes, there will be a lot of images and volumes, and I believe that the heartbeat will be very big, and maybe the 15 gigabyte with tens of images and volumes. You can just calculate in this way. Let's say we have 10,000 nodes. So what will be like for the result? I believe we will have two problems. One is if we have a frequent updating of the node, image nodes, in the etcd, there will be very big etc transaction nodes for the etcd. We can just know that there will be a lot of latency, and the data will be the apiserver. CPU consumption will be very high. We know this node image is very big, and this sequence will be very big, so that's why we need to we need to figure out this problem. In Kubernetes, in order to tackle the problem I just mentioned, it add a new needs built-in API for the node and heartbeats. We must know this latent status of this node. We can just judge whether it is read or not read. The node object, we can just add this list object. Each node has its own object and it also has other lists. With this list, the Kubernetes heartbeat can be modified into the update this list with every 10 seconds. If you look at this right controller, and you can just judge whether this node is available, is useful or not. With this list, this cycle can be very short. Due to time constraint, I cannot show with whether this time can be shorter. Yes, it can be shorter. For this list object, one of the benefits is that it's very small. And I believe that it's 100 bytes and it's lightweight in within etcd. The transaction node will be very small. And if you look at its functionality in this enabled 1.1014, it's a default open. And I believe that if you can just you have some problem, you can scan it whether you can update it to the 1.14 version.
After we've solved the heartbeat issues, power functionality is one aspect. However, we need to deploy several nodes in an HA cluster. Under this HA cluster, we might deploy several nodes due to different reasons. If we want to upgrade the API server, you will see that all of the pressure just load to one node. That is not what we expected. And in order to solve this problem, we need to add a load. We thought about whether we need to add a load balancer. We also talked about because the biggest pressure comes from one from heartbeat. So we thought about maybe we can add one load balancer. We don't know whether you have your own cluster or you create a cluster in cloud. So if it is in the cloud, then usually it will have a load balancer itself. However, that doesn't really solve the problem. And we thought about another solution, which is to deploy a load balancer in the net terminal. However, that also doesn't really solve the problem. The reason why this problem happens is because it's very simple, actually, because Kubernetes, Kubernetes core made a lot of efforts. They use HTTPS to communicate, and in order to reduce the connection, persistent connection, and in order to reduce the heads up overhead, so when Kubernetes and apiserver established a connection, the connection will always be there, will not be broken. And now that we know this problem, to solve it is also very simple. Firstly, we know that the client is not trustworthy. We need to have a protection mechanism, and there are two ways. Firstly, we can, when we operate one request, then we can send too many requests when exceeded the load. And the second way is to, when the value is too high, then we can just reject the client. Another solution is that when we upgrade the server, we can try to use max search. Because if you want to upgrade it, when you upgrade the last one's traffic is really high. But if you use max search, point 3, because there are 3 nodes there, and then you will have a load balancing automatically. And in order to have a better load balancing, we have another strategy, which is to, here we have 2 retries. Firstly, it's to try another server if there are too many requests. Just connect to another API server, and the other one is try another server after 7 minutes. If it is already very balanced, then after 7 minutes we will establish another TLS connection. But if you want to rebuild another connection, will that have negative impact? Actually, it will not, because we need to control the frequency of rebuilding. You can calculate by yourself, if you rebuild one per every 5 minutes, what kind of pressure will it generate? You can see they are very acceptable. And you can also see this diagram here. There are 4 nodes, and the pressure on each node are actually the same, almost the same. And you can see whether this cluster can recover fast, rapidly. Load balancing problem can be solved by this method. But in API server, there is one problem. If you did Kubernetes develop before, you can see that the key communication mechanism between a client and server is list watch and cacher. All of the typical objects have the will update one list, and the API server will have a reflector to watch the data on the etcd. You can see that all of the codes can be reused afterwards, and in this mechanism, there is one problem. If the watch is broken, it's disconnected, and maybe the network is broken, you have to retry. So in order to guarantee the consistency of the data, we will have a release number. When you retry, it will give you the number of the server, and then the server will use the number to check. So after 5, it will start from 7 and send data starting from 7. If informers focus on port, it will create port and will also destroy port, so the series afterwards will also be updated. However, that will also lead to another question, because for Kubernetes, it will also only focus on its own data. If the data come from other nodes updated and that link to the disconnection, so API server will notice that my Siri doesn't have 5, so it cannot answer the question that so between 5 and 7, 6 is missing. I don't know whether 6 is there, was there or not. So it has to let the client know that you have a too old version error. In this circumstance, overhead is really large, and also the Kubernetes controller. Because controller is focused on a lot of data, and that will lead to a lot of a very large latency. In order to solve this problem, in Kubernetes, we introduce a bookmark in watch, and the rationale is actually very simple, because it only focuses on a certain part of data. If this part of data is not updated and the rest of the data is updated, so you can establish a heartbeat mechanism here. Even if the data I cared is not updated, then version number will be updated. The number is 5, but if the version number is updated, then the number will be triggered. After Informa get the version, and it will automatically know that the number is 12.
This
kind of mechanism is very helpful, especially in when HS reboot. Sometimes you might need to push up several thousands of data events. We already released as 1.15. If you met some problem, it's too old problem, you can consider to open that question, that function.
So
Kubernetes and controller will use controller to get the data. However, when we are developing, sometimes we want to gather data from the client. You might need to execute daily. To avoid additional overhead, you can have another solution. There are several API nodes, and when it returns the data, you don't know which node it's come from. So Kubernetes 4 will forward to etcd.
Etcd,
but there will be two problems. Firstly, the etcd is unable to support indexing. And for the node object, it will be saved in node. And the returning model is very simple. You can only, it is only by name or by server. If you want to look for all of the pods in one node, the overhead will be very large. You have to get all of the load in the pod in the one node. And then second, the request, you cannot request for a lot of data. So that's why it has a page reading to avoid too much overhead. And this page reading mechanism will lead to multiple round trip in the back end. The reason why we need to visit the HPC is because we need to solve the one-time off problems. So we can try not to visit etcd, and when you visit the server will only request the current version number. We know that HPSD will watch etcd, so apiserver only need to wait for the update number to see whether the number is updated. If it is already updated, then HPServer has already cached the data in etcd. That means the visit is consistent. Then you can return to the client request. It has two advantages. First, you don't have to have the page reading. Because the client and API server is a linear request. So it will not lead to a large overhead. And the second, by using this method, you can have an index in the API server. You don't have to identify all of the pods. Apart from node, we can also add some of the other labels. Maybe you need to check some of the normal keys. One of the typical benchmarks is when you describe a node. In a 10,000 node, it takes 5 seconds. However, now it only takes 0.3 seconds. You can see that inside the server, you have to visit all of the etc. In the 5 seconds, 4 of the seconds is visiting etcd. However, after the indexing or labeling, it's so much faster. Because the describe load has a lot of interaction, it is not just a one time of interaction. The function, this kind of function is very dependent on XCD 1.4, so in the 1.6 version, we will add this function.
Okay, now,
finally, I want to talk about the controller optimization. In the Kubernetes model, server is stateless. However, the controller's unavailability will also lead to a server unavailability. Sometimes you send a request, however, the request will not be dealt with. So you have to transform the deployment to port. And in a large scale cluster, the controller informer will store millions of objects, and that's several GB. When the controller is failed, it will go to the bay will become a new cluster and to synchronize the data in server. However, it will create a large overhead and it will take several minutes, especially you use a lot of CRD in your daily work. This kind of problem can happen a lot. So in order to solve this problem, we had a very simple organization. Because it's very slow to synchronize the data, so we use controller to have the informer in the beta. So when it becomes a group, it will not need to synchronize the data. Especially when we update, the controller is killed, and the group controller will release list on seek terms. And that will have a restarting the controller only takes several seconds. So the master controller, a restart master controller only takes several seconds, and if it is an abnormal broken, then you have to wait a few time, 15 seconds to wait for the controller to restart.
Okay,
thank you. If you have any question, you can ask me. In the last slide, the controller failover. The current lecture is standby. It will not visit controller. So does it mean you need to modify the original code? Maybe you can just have to move it up, move the whole logic up. We will actually synchronize them in the community. I have one more question. I know Kubernetes and has six scalability. So if you will use Sigma's work to test your system, or have you prepared your own? We have our own workload based on our scenario, because our data scenario is different. One more question. Well, thank you so much for your speech. I noticed you talk about Sigma and Kubernetes. What's the relationship between the two? The original name is called Sigma. Sigma is based on Alice Wang and is an independent researched invoke engine. And in 2018, we have a very comprehensive ecosystem. So we have the Sigma to download and exchange them into Kubernetes. So it's a cloud native. So it's reiteration and replace them in the underlying layer. Thank you.